so thankful for all of you again that are here this morning. Y'all are so smiley today. Amen. It's so great. Look at somebody and just tell them, thank you for smiling at me. Thank you for being filled with joy and hope and peace and power. Amen. 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 Yes. All right. We're going to 1 Peter chapter number 2. First Peter chapter number 2, verse number 9. Amen. First Peter chapter 2, verse number 9. And we are going to be spending the next month or so really leaning into a conversation about what does it mean for you and I to continue to not only acknowledge the soul food and the soul force that we are wanting and hoping to have stored up real good through our season of consecration, but what does it also mean for us to bear witness? And today's sermon will hopefully remind us who we are and what we are called to do and how we are called to do it. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, I think it's a wonderful, wonderful reminder of all of these truths, and I'm excited for us to launch into this series in the name of the Lord. Thank God for Lady Sharice being here as always. Let's thank God for her. Amen. She did a wonderful job. My daughter turned 5 earlier this week, and she gave her a party for the ages. Amen. And just thank God for her. Amen. I told Nyla that, amen, everything goes down from here now. Praise God. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Because I don't know how many more of these things we got in us, both in our bank account and our creativity. Amen. But they say I only turned 5 once. Amen. So why not just go all out? All right. 1 Peter chapter number 2, verse 9. The word of the Lord says, but you are the ones chosen by God, chosen for the high calling of priestly work, chosen to be a holy people, God's instruments to do this work and speak out for him, to tell others of the night and day difference God made for you, from nothing to something, from rejected to accepted. Amen. I think we should read that again. Amen. That was some good stuff. Amen. But you are the ones chosen by God, chosen for the high calling of priestly work, chosen to be a holy people, God's instruments to do his work and speak out for him, to tell others of the night and day difference God made for you, from nothing to something, from rejected to accepted. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Let us say thanks be to God. So today we will spend this next few moments talking about this is who we are. This is who we are. Bow your heads with me. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the word of God that has been read for us, the people of God. We ask you to hide this word in our hearts so we will not sin against you. And please send your anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. Let it rest upon me and even the hearers of this word. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the people of God say amen. Tell your neighbor, don't forget who you are. Don't forget who you are. And this is so important, I believe, because the world is shaped by very powerful storytellers, people who have majored in the science and the art of describing the reality, or dare I say, the alternate reality of the world. And if we are not careful, and if we are not grounded in a sense of God's story And that story, as it has unfolded through the lives of real people in real places, we can easily become overwhelmed by the stories, the narratives, and the descriptions of our day. Now, it is such an important and powerful concept to know and believe that the creator of the universe has an opinion about who we are. I mean, you know, I have an opinion about a few folk, praise God. I know some folk got an opinion about me. And, you know, while their opinions may carry some weight at a particular moment in time, I am always humbled to the point sometimes of great fear and anxiety when I think that God has an opinion about Michael McBride. I mean, God has an opinion about what I do, who I do it to, how I do it, when I do it, if I do it. That God is not disinterested in my life. God is not disinterested in our lives. That God, in God's wisdom and God's power and God's plan, has a purpose for us that in many respects is more weighty and long-lasting than the opinion of the person sitting next to you, behind you, or with you on your job, in your car, in your neighborhood. The idea that this story of who we are to God matters. And it influences the way we ought to live. I am a great fan and proponent of knowing what God believes and says about us. And I always think it's worthwhile to point in our history to recover so we don't think that we have a free pass or a free slate or a blank slate, if you will, of what God requires of God's people in moments of our lives. I am certainly, as we stated a few moments ago, thankful that during this month of February, the minds and the imaginations and the memories of many folk in our country will turn to the contributions of Black folk to the development and the progress and the struggle of this country, particularly because Black history reminds us of the struggle descendants of African slaves have had to make to be fully human in a land that would deny our divine right to be so. It is a reminder that even though there were some folk who would try and take the sacred text and lock us into a status of dehumanization and second class or no class citizenship, God was able to take that very same text and use it as an agent and tool of our liberation. That the story of God in the biblical text and through the memory of even those who came through the passages of the Atlantic and suffered through chattel slavery and Jim Crow and the new Jim Crow, dare I say, that for some reason, even those folk, even today, who would still try to appeal to terrible theological suppositions to make sense of a fallen world that would dehumanize some folk, there is still a people who can take that same text and say that God has a liberation and a freedom that every person should experience. And that is not something that is contingent upon who's in power politically, but it is something that flows out of God's imagination and call of who we are. History helps you and I, then, I think, to not be held hostage to the tragedy and the terror of the moment. But it helps us to have, hopefully, an open mind a wild imagination about what is possible if we continue to reach back using the Sankofa principle in a way where we don't forget where we come from, and how we came through may also be instructive in how we move forward. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm also clear that it is not a given that folk will use the story of God's activity through our lives and in our lives in a liberative manner. I mean, I think it was Karl Marx who claimed that religion is nothing more than an opiate for the masses. And I can look around and see what Karl Marx was talking about. When I talk to some folk and I hear the foolishness that comes out of their mouth under the guise of religion, I say, all right, so Karl Marx must have been talking to you, amen, before he wrote that part of his work a few years ago, because clearly you are high on something that has you deceived. Touch your neighbor, somebody. But this is even the more reason why you and I must bear witness publicly through our lives that there is a way that seems right unto us, but the end is destruction. And so our job is not to continue to repeat the historical errors that are often, you know, in the hearts of many folk. I mean, you know, I find it so fascinating that when you don't study history and learn from history, you will repeat the exact same error of history. Somebody said there's nothing new under the sun, right? So that means that there must be something about what's in the heart of humanity that if we don't remain in a posture of learning and development, that we will do the exact same evil that was done before you even got here. Give your neighbor a high five and tell them, don't repeat those mistakes. Don't repeat those mistakes. It is in this way that how we remember history, how we tell the story of history, who gets to tell that story, it all matters. I mean, we are living in a time where we see that folks are creating new ways of talking about not just history, but the present. We see that there are political forces that will trot people out in front of the camera and talk about alternative facts, and they will make up events to try and reinforce the terrible policy decisions that are being made. And the scariest part about it is that there are some folk who actually will buy into these distortions of not just the past, but also the present. I believe that part of why it matters that we are God's people, particularly followers of Jesus, is because we are a part of God's never-ending story in the world. Let us be reminded that every week since Jesus was killed by the Roman Empire, folks have been gathering all across the world, literally every week, to remind themselves of God's story. Every week, people have been taking communion, what we will do today, to remind themselves of the sacrifice that was made and how that sacrifice of Jesus performs in our lives to create a people called out of the world to show forth the praises of the Creator. That we are a part of a story. You are a part of a story. And our story must always ground who we are, or we will be easily manipulated to sign up into somebody else's story. And somebody else's story will always have some appeal to our story. They'll talk about the part of you that you are very passionate about. It could be your race, it could be your gender, it could be your sexual orientation, it could be your nation of origin, it could be your class designation, it could be the size of your family, it could be your sports team, it could be your career, it could be your academic achievement, it could be the stimulation of your mind, it could be the concern for your body. Somebody has a story that will always be appealing to parts of us. But there will be moments where we have to make sure that all of these parts of us that add up to make us the unique person God has called us to be, that part of us will not take preeminence or authority or priority over what God has called us to do. Because how many of you know the world would love to carve you and I up into these categories? Into these categories that will not give you or I a full description of who God created us to be, and then pit us against one another and cause us to forget that we are all God's creation. You see, what is so fascinating about the life of Jesus, I believe, is that when Jesus moved around the Palestinian Roman Empire part of the world, Jesus seemed to make connections with everybody. Even to the chagrin of folks following him. Jesus had a few disciples, right? Like, hey, I got me a band of homies, so we gonna rock and let's rock. And his homies had all kind of prejudices and biases, but Jesus still let them follow him, which is a trip. How many know it gives some of us in here a little bit of hope? Praise God. Touch your neighbor, somebody, right? I mean, Jesus was rocking with all kind of folk that if you put them in a room and took Jesus out of the equation, it'll be Royal Rumble, WrestleMania, Clash of the Titans. Jesus had a zealot in his band of homies. His disciples. Zealots were like the revolutionaries who were advocating for the overthrow of the Roman government. And he had a tax collector who was actually the one scheming everybody to support the Roman government. What was it about Jesus? He could attract all these kind of folk and transform their lives in such a way that they would literally die before renouncing that they had been with Jesus. Woo! Tell your neighbor, I got a long way to go. I got a long way to go. help me, somebody. Amen. When Jesus was doing his ministry, Jesus would hang out with women that everybody else thought had a little bit of a challenging reputation. Jesus would heal the sick children of the centurions. You know, that's like the police of the day. Let me say, it's the military of the day, the occupying army of the day. Jesus was working to reconcile all of the disparate parts of humanity, because Jesus was more moved by his purpose than his social location. And I want to submit to you, child of God, that if we're going to be faithful in this season, we got to remember who we are. Because this season will call you and I, ask of you and I things that we may not be able to comply with if we remember who we are. Someone was asking me about all these executive orders that President Trump and his administration are trying to push through. And isn't it fascinating? I remember when I was in Ferguson, and they told us that while we were marching, we had to stay off the sidewalk while we were marching, and we could not stop moving, or we would be arrested. And there were folk out there saying, that's against the law. It's like, no, it's not. And if you stop marching and you take a rest on the sidewalk, we're going to arrest you. And people got arrested. We had to pay bail, get folk out of jail. And our comrades at ACLU and the Advancement Project and all our homies out there ended up taking them to court while we were still out there protesting and ended up winning the injunction or the court case that said that the police were asking us to do things that were not legal. So they had to formally stop giving us those commands. But how many know it was illegal before the court said it was illegal? And see, there are going to be some things in this moment where the child of God is going to have to say, I know in my heart, because of who I am and the stories that have produced me, that I can't comply with this unjust law or this unjust order. I can't stand by and watch the people I know and love be harmed because of an arbitrary declaration from somebody who obviously has nefarious intentions or who is radically ignorant. Pick one, it does not matter. You see, when we come to the text, you and I should appreciate that First Peter was actually written, many of folks say, by Peter during the time that Nero was the emperor of Rome. And if you know anything about Nero, he was a crazy man. He was a man, many folk thought, that was so paranoid about people trying to do things and take things from him that he contributed to the whole empire imploding. And it even says that while Rome was burning, he was having a party. I don't know about y'all, but even today when we will all celebrate and watch the Super Bowl and have a great party, could it be that things are burning all around us? So what will the church be in this moment? Will we be folks who cheer on the party from our religious, theological positions and places in society? Or will we be those who will say that I will not join this ridiculous expression and celebration of our demise? But we will be a people who will be a refuge, a source of resistance, a clarion call and reminder that this is not the way God intended or intends for us to be. And it won't flow out of an arbitrary sense of good, but it will come out of our clear sense of who God has created us to be. That's why the words of Peter writing to Christians living in the time of Nero, many of these Christians were hiding out because Nero was trying to kill a bunch of them. Many of them were having church, listen to this, in cemeteries and graveyards because that was the only place that the Roman soldiers were afraid to go. Many of them were losing their jobs and having to let go of their property because of the level of persecution, because they refused to denounce their witness of Jesus. Now, I don't know if we're all going to have to get to that place, but I do know this, that if you do not, and we do not, have the strength to resist and bear witness to a future of justice and peace and salvation and holiness and inclusion and love and healing, if we can't resist all the forces that are trying, regardless of if it's Trump or if it's all our progressive friends who seem to govern in this Bay Area but can't seem to care for the poor, if you and I can't resist these forces, however they show up, then I want to submit to you, we have forgotten who we are. And it is not for me or you to get too comfortable, too holier than thou. Well, I didn't vote for Trump. You sure didn't. At least I hope you didn't. But what are you voting for here? I didn't campaign for him. Well, that's great. But what are you advocating for here? Can your life and our lives be so clearly following the ways of Jesus that people can look at us and say, my goodness, I am clear about who informs your agenda? Even if other folk don't believe in Jesus, could they at least believe in the power of your witness? See, that's how I want to live. I want to live in such a way where whether you believe in Jesus or not, you're going to believe in the way I live. You're going to believe in what we care about. So the first thing that I think the scripture lifts up from this text that is worthy of our consideration is you are the ones chosen by God. Somebody holler, I've been chosen. Now, the significance of you being chosen by God should not be lost on you. Because if you take a look through the text, it is clear that God, for some reason, chooses some folk to do assignments versus other folk. God chose Abel and rejected Cain. God chose David and rejected his brothers. God decided to choose Rahab to save, Rahab the harlot, the prostitute, to save the whole city. That if God wants to choose you out of all your family members and all the folk in your neighborhood and all the folk in your class, you ought to ask yourself, well, God, if you can choose me, why am I so uncomfortable being chosen? What is it about how I've been shaped by the stories of this world that will make me feel like I am unworthy or ill-equipped to do the thing that I am called to do in this moment? Some folk paralyzed by what we are to do. But I tell folk all the time, at least since, you know, these recent developments, that our ancestors have given everything that they could and deposited it in our genes and our bones. So you and I could stand up in this moment and be who God has created us to be. And just in case that's not enough, because most of the time it isn't, for the follower of Jesus, God gives you the Spirit. Hello, somebody. You know, the old saints call it the Holy Ghost. That thing that gives you supernatural power. Folk asking, how you get that done? Oh, I thank God for the Holy Ghost. Anybody ever heard someone say that? I thank God for the Holy Ghost. Well, I thank God for the, what is that? Holy Ghost, you talking about Casper the Friendly Ghost? No, I'm talking about the Holy Ghost. Give your neighbor a high five and tell him, I thank God for the Holy Ghost. I thank God. What will this Holy Ghost do? This Holy Ghost will help me love you. This Holy Ghost will help our marriage stay together. This Holy Ghost will help me pray for my child. Go visit my loved one in the jail. This Holy Ghost will give me the strength to march out in the streets when the police is cracking down on our head. This Holy Ghost will give me the courage to resist on my job. Believe that my source is not in my paycheck, but my source comes from God. When you are chosen, you are aware that not only do you have the Holy Ghost, but the Holy Ghost got you. You ought to give your neighbor one more high five and tell him, I'm glad the Holy Ghost got me. To be chosen, then requires you and I to do something that is supernatural or at least kind of standing out from those around you. Because you got an extra fuel. I got me a nice new car for my 40th birthday last year, and it's one of these turbo cars. So when I'm driving on the freeway and somebody, you know, is trying to, like, not let me over, you know, being a hater and whatnot, praise God, and my exit is coming, my wife knows what to do. Buckle in. Because I'm not one of these folk who believe in passive driving on the freeway, praise God. I believe you got to make a way out of no way. Touch your neighbor. Amen. That's just me. Now, I'm not advocating for y'all to be reckless in your driving. But the kind of car I have allows me to do that. Because I put my foot on that pedal and another thing jumps in. And that car be like, boop, 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 boop. And I'd be like, peace. Hello, somebody. That extra bit of turbo that is a part of my car that I chose helps me to have a little bit of more than someone who don't have that. You ought to take a look at yourself, your situation, on your job, in your family, in your neighborhood, in this season. Do you have that extra that allows you and I to demonstrate how chosen we are? See, most folk like to talk about being chosen. Keep reminding people, don't you know who I am? This is who I am. I'm Reverend Dr. Bishop, Archbishop, Highness. If you got to keep reminding people of who you are, then you got a little bit of work to reflect who you are. So let me get to these questions here. First thing, what keeps you from embracing that you are God's choice? It's a good question for all of us to think about, because these stories that we often hear will tell us our gender, our race, our age, our class, our education is a disqualifier for you living out your chosenness. Some folks say, well, I don't have enough money, I don't have enough this. But how many know if God has chosen you, you have everything you need? Can you imagine what it'd been like if our ancestors was like, man, we don't got no TV show? How can we do all this stuff and we don't have what they have? Somebody said in the meeting, probably, well, this is what we do have. And I am more convinced about what God has given us to use than what they are trying to tell us we don't have. Hallelujah. Also, what then requires you to do something different in this season of your life if you are indeed chosen? Second thing I believe this scripture lifts up that I think is worthy of our consideration is we are God's instrument. Somebody holler, I am his instrument. Listen, to do God's work and speak out for him. What does it mean that you are an instrument of God? You are God's tool. You are an extension of God. We say it all the time. We are the arms and the legs of God in the world. Huh? That we have the ability. I mean, this is another way of asking it. If you are an instrument, who is playing you? Who's playing you? Now be clear. There are a lot of folk out here that are trying to play us. I was in my week-long retreat at the Rockwood Institute of Leadership, and it was 5 days of just, you know, they pretty much trying to get everybody to cry, you know, because it's just one of them kind of things where, you know, making you just, you know, do all this deep introspection and talk about your leadership and those things that keep you from being what you need to be, and talking about courageous conversation. I mean, it was great, but at a certain point, I was like, I like my emotions right where they are. Amen. I don't need, I'm up here, y'all, around all these strangers. You got trying to get me to cry and snot, and I just can't do it. It's too much. But one of the sessions I found particularly helpful was a session on being triggered. And talked about how, depending on our life, circumstance, story, and journey, we all have triggers that can easily be touched and stroked that will create an immediate response that you won't even be able to catch until after it happens. Anybody ever been there before? Somebody does something to you, and you're just like, blah, 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 like, ooh, ooh. Like, I'm sorry, Jesus, I'm trying to live right. Right? Triggered. You be talking to your partner, your spouse, your child, whoever, and all of a sudden, you say stuff, and you trying to unring the bell. You just know, man, I just went too far. I know I just went too far. You're trying to stay clean and sober, and all of a sudden you hear a certain song or smell a certain scent. And all of a sudden your mouth start watering or a trigger. Or are you trying to live as an advocate for justice and the great Cheeto in y'all pray for me, I'm being petty. The president of the United States does something that triggers you. Hello, somebody. Y'all forgive me, I'm so sorry. Lord, forgive me, I got too carnal right there. Triggered. When you are not positioning your life in such a way where God is the one in charge of playing your instrument, you give your instrument into the hands of someone who may be able to manipulate you into doing things that cause you to forget who you are. So how do you deal with making sure that your triggers, your predispositions, your idiosyncrasies, your challenges do not set us up in such a way where we are triggered to do things that rob us of being able to be God's instrument, to play beautiful music, to accomplish significant purposes where we've been called to be? You may need to be God's instrument on your job. But folk on your job trigger you in a way that they play you real easily. There are some folk who are gifted in playing folk. And I believe each one of us got at least one or two folk in the course of our lives that they can play us and have us just going around in circles to the point that you get so dizzy that you don't know where you're going. How can you and I be an instrument that allows us to be played by God to do what God says? God's work and speak for God. So that's two things. If you're doing God's work, you don't get to write your own job description. And if you speak for God, you don't get to say what God does not say. Now that's hard for a lot of us because many of us like our fake notions of free will. But don't you know theologically, this is going to mess up somebody. The theological concept of free will is not that you get to choose what you want to do. The Augustinian notion of free will is that when given the choice, you will choose right every time. So that's why, you know, you and I are only free when we can choose the good. And because none of us can choose it without a struggle, we are always then wrestling and striving for freedom. At least from a Christian theological point of view. I think that's a worthy idea to wrestle with because it helps me again to depend on what we were talking about a few minutes ago, the Holy Ghost, to make up the difference. Lord, I want to do your will. Jesus, when he was in the garden, this Jesus now, this ain't just like Pookie. This Jesus getting ready to do what he was put on the earth to do. Die for the sins of the world. And yet, Jesus said, if you can get me out of this one, I won't be upset. There's got to be another way to save these folk. I know McBride is a piece of work, but good God. Not my will, though. See, that's what the Holy Ghost will do for you and I. When we are the instrument of God, the Holy Spirit will help us be able to be in a place where we can say, not my will, but your will be done. I know it's hard. I know it's difficult, but I know that in this moment and season, I am called to be your instrument in a place that is devoid of your clear working. Questions, who is playing you? By whom are you being played? How can you ensure that God is having maximum purpose and impact through your life's assignments? Then the last thing we'll talk about before we move into our time of that our being chosen and our being an instrument should add up to make a difference. How? From nothing to something, from rejected to accepted. Something from rejected to accepted, and ask yourself, how is this translating in my life and in the community? I'm called to live, serve, lead, impact. Think of all the people who have been convinced that they are nothing. Think of all the odds that have been told to us as a people that would tell us we are nothing. Think of all the experience that have added up abuse, loneliness, abandonment, violence, discrimination that would try and reduce us to nothingness. But God comes in and makes us something. Hallelujah. Makes us something that is so appealing that other folks take notice and say, man, I remember where you came from. I remember where you were at 10 years ago, last week, last night. Tell your neighbor, but God brought me from a mighty long way. I remember what it means to move from nothing to something. Jesus, when he opened up his arms and invited us to come and walk and follow, Jesus said, you were once rejected, but so was I. The scripture says that I used to be the one who was rejected, but now I have become the chief cornerstone. Meaning that this building can't stand unless my stone is a part of this structure. You used to be the one everybody chose last. But now they realize they can't go forward without you being on their team. In your family, you were the one that were called the quote-unquote black sheep. You had too many strikes against you. In your group, you couldn't comprehend the depth of the intellectual conversations and inquiry. In your family, your marriage, your job, your community, you were the one everybody seemed to have muscle memory to reject. But when God came into your life, somehow when God accepted you and you realized you were accepted by God, you did not care about who accepted you. And when you stopped caring about who accepted you, you realized you then became accepted. Hallelujah. I'm here to tell you today that this is who we are. And you can't forget it. You can't allow your circumstance, our circumstance, this season in history to make us forget who we are. Because if you can remember who you are, you will be consistent. You will be faithful. You will be a difference maker. People will know that when you step through the door, hallelujah, that you are changing the environment. I love how Dr. King asked the question, are you a thermostat or are you a thermometer? And some of us need to ask ourselves that question today. Are you the person who only measures what's happening in the room? Or are you the one who actually gets to determine the temperature in the room? And I want you to know, child of God, that this is the moment where God needs his people to stand up and say, I will determine what is righteous. I will determine what is just. I will determine who is loved. I will determine who is accepted. I will determine who is healed, because this is who I am. This is who God created me to be, and I shall be who God created me to be. We shall be God's people in this moment. We will not be hiding and shrinking in a corner. We may have seasons of depression. We may have seasons of incapacity. We may succumb to our human weakness. But even in those seasons of human weakness, expect the reminder from God, who will help you remember